creating focus within our salah and bringing quality to our prayers. As Sheikh Hassan mentioned after the salah, the injunction within the Qur'an, the directive that is provided in the Qur'an and in the Sunnah, the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, is to have an element within prayer which is called khushu. And to define and to discuss the meaning of khushu requires a little bit more time. It's a bit of a linguistic type discussion. But to kind of step away from that for tonight, to be able to get to the core of the issue, I'm going to refer for this session that we're going to have here tonight, I'm basically going to allude, I'm going to refer to khushu in prayer as quality within our salah. So how do we exactly go about finding quality within our prayers? Because there's so much resting on that. There's so much vested in finding quality within our prayers. Again, as Sheikh Hassan mentioned after the salah, the Quran says that success depends upon the quality within our prayers. So if it's such, you know, the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ tells us that the very first, أَوَّلُ مَا يُحَاسَبُ عَلَيْهِ الْعَبْدُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ الصَّلَاةِ, that the very first thing that the slave will be held accountable for on the day of resurrection is the prayer. فَإِن صَلُحَتْ, if it is correct, if the prayer was in order, if it was done properly, صَلُحَ سَائِرُ عَمَلِي, then all the rest of his actions will work out. وَإِنْ فَسَدَتْ, but if the prayer was corrupted, if it was messed up, right, his prayer was not in order, فَسَدَ سَعِيُّ عَمَلِي, then all the rest of his actions will be accordingly, you know, messed up, out of sync, will not be correct. So there's so much resting within, on this prayer, in the quality of this prayer. So now how do we exactly go about in finding that quality within our prayers? And that's the basic premise of tonight's discussion. The very first thing I'd like to do is explain what is the historical significance and what is the historical role of prayer within Islam. What role did the prayer, did this salah play within the history of our deen and the history of this religion? So in order to talk about that, I'd like for us to take into consideration one of the most difficult moments of the life of the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him. One of the most difficult moments of his life, personally speaking. Probably the greatest personal tragedy endured by the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that was a year from the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Meccan era, which is referred to as Amul Husn, the year of grief or the year of sorrow. And what exactly happened in that year is something very interesting. It's really profound. You know, in the weekly seerah class that I teach at ICI at the Irving Masjid, we just covered these sessions in the last couple of weeks where we discussed and we talked about the marriage of the Prophet ﷺ to his beloved wife Khadija radiallahu anha. And you have to understand who Khadija was, right? Because a lot of times, and this is something that I often complain about in these types of sessions and gatherings and study of the Quran or the life of the Prophet ﷺ, that unfortunately today we have a very entertainment-like approach to studying the life of the Messenger ﷺ. What I mean by that is, whenever we talk about the life of the Messenger ﷺ, if it's got to be something new, it's got to be something, you know, I haven't heard before, I've never come across before. And if somebody is talking about something that's already been previously covered, like for instance, if I was to come here and talk about the Battle of Badr, or if I was to come here and do a tafsir of, you know, Surah Al-Qadr, and Sheikh Yasir did that maybe 3-4 weeks ago, the very first question or suggestion would be like, brother, we've already covered this topic, let's cover something new. Because there's no focus, there's no attention on extracting the lessons, implementing that within our lives, or trying to derive the wisdom and the benefit from it. It's all basically entertainment to us. Because if you've seen an episode of a TV show once, and you turn on the television, and that same episode is coming on again, do you sit and watch it again? Do you? No, what do? Change the channel, watch something else. All right, maybe it was a really good episode, one of the best ones they've had for that show. Then maybe you watch it a second time. But then you turn on the TV a few days later and that same episode is rerunning, they're showing you for the third time in a row, are you going to sit and watch it? No, you're not. All right, you're gonna change your channel, you're gonna watch something else. All right, let's say you channel surfed all the way around, there's absolutely nothing else coming on. Then possibly you might watch it a third time, but at this time you're paying kind of half attention. You can say the lines before they say their lines. You deliver the punchline before they do. But if you're finally sinning and it comes on for a fourth time, are you going to sit and watch that episode again? Are you? Hopefully not, okay? All right, because if you do, then you have other types of issues, all right? One that's outside of the realm of salah or prayer, okay? But nevertheless, the point is, and also unless you're a guy watching SportsCenter, that's a disease, all right? So where we watch one SportsCenter after another, after another, after another, not realizing that they just keep showing the same highlights over and over again, right? And that's a different issue, all right? So, but you don't. That's entertainment. You need something new. You need something exciting. You need something that I haven't heard before. So unfortunately, today when we approach our deen, a lot of times we have an entertainment-like approach. And so how do we go about exactly correcting that? The very first thing we have to do is we have to focus in on, you know, what lessons can be extracted from there. And we actually, when it comes to the life of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we have to be able to understand and access the human side of the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam so that this message and this story becomes relatable for us. How can we extract some benefit? How can we relate to this experience of the Messenger of Allah, peace and blessings be upon him? So, I was talking about that year. It's mentioned by the historians, the scholars of Sirah, to be the 11th year of prophethood. The beloved wife of the Prophet of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the mother of the believers, Khadija radiallahu anha, may Allah be pleased with her, she passed away. And understand that a lot of times, again, when we read the Sirah, or you're looking at a website, you click next, and you click next, and you click next, and you move right on. But what did that mean to the Messenger of Allah? What was that like for the Prophet of Allah? The Prophet of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam had been married to Khadija radiallahu anha for more than 25 years. He'd been married to her for 25 years. Alright? Just to be able to kind of understand, engage what that means, raise your hand if you're under the age of 25. Okay? That's a lot of people, mashallah. Alright? Basically, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam had been married to Khadija radiallahu anha longer than they've been alive, he had been married to her longer than that. Imagine 25 years of spending your most private, intimate moments with your spouse, with another human being. Sharing the most intimate experiences of your life with someone. It sounds very cheesy and it sounds kind of cliche, but it's the truth. That Khadija radiallahu anha was the love of the Prophet ﷺ's life. She was his soulmate. She was his partner in life. She was his rock. You know, as the story tells us, the hadith, the seerah tells us that when the Prophet ﷺ received divine revelation, he came home and spoke to who first? Spoke to his wife. And she consoled him. And she motivated him. And she inspired him. And she supported him. She meant the world to him. She was the mother of his children. 6 of his 7 children were born to Khadija radiallahu anha. This is his wife, his partner in life, his best friend, the mother of his children. The first believer, the first follower. When he said, fine Khadija, okay, everything makes sense, but who's going to accept, who's going to believe in this? Look at the time, the era that we live in. Who's going to accept and believe this? She said, you're worried about somebody accepting and believing? Ashhadu an la ilaha illa Allah. Wa ashhadu annaka rasul. She was the first believer. She meant so much to him. And he just lost her. I want you to try to imagine and experience what that would be like. And you know, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all of us from going through something like that. But at the same time, how do we get a more personal feel for what that was like? Because you really can't know what that's like unless you've been through it. So I was kind of talking about this in a lecture. This is almost now 4 years ago. I was talking about this, and after I got, it was actually Jum'ah khutbah, and I was telling this story of Amr al-Husn, the year of grief and sorrow in the khutbah. And this brother came up to me afterwards, and you know, people always, they come up to you and they say, Assalamu alaikum, jazakallah khair, thank you very much, etc., etc. Feedback after the khutbah, right? So, hopefully it's not more negative than it is positive, but people usually come up and they give you some type of feedback on your khutbah, or they just come to say salam. This one brother came up, and he was like, you know what you mentioned and what you said in the khutbah, it really personally hit home for me. Like it really hit home with me. I connected with it. And a lot of people, like I said, give you feedback, but sometimes, occasionally, somebody's just got that look in their eye where it tells you that they got a story to tell. They have a story to tell. So I asked his brother, if you don't mind, if it's not too personal, do you mind sharing with me how it relates to you personally? So we sat down and he told me that today was the first time that I've prayed in almost a year. I grew up, I was born in a Muslim family, in a Muslim home, very religious, both my parents were practicing, we were all raised with deen, but today was the first time I prayed in almost a year. I said, Ajeem, SubhanAllah, what happened, brother? And he told me that about a year ago, my wife passed away. And he told me the story. He said about a year ago, I was in my early, you know, I was in my late 20s, early 30s. And I was at that point, that phase in my life where, you know, the master plan, it all starts to kind of come together. Everything is working out as you planned it. I was nearing the end of my medical residency, becoming a doctor. I was starting to feel the offers from clinics and hospitals and groups and things like that. Lucrative offers, mashallah. And I was married, I had a young wife, we had been married for a few years. You know, we had a couple of small little kids, like babies. And now that I was getting offers, we were looking at nice areas, we were looking at nice houses to buy. You know, the life of a student or a med student or a medical resident, it's really tough. Long work, long hours, live on a very small budget. So we lived in a small little apartment, not a great neighborhood. We drove one car, beat up old car. So now we went minivan shopping. We were looking at nice houses. We were looking at nice schools for the kids. Like, everything's working out. And so one day I came home from work a little bit sooner than I normally would. And I walked in, I said salam. No response. So I figured it was the time when they all take a nap. So I figured, you know what, I'm not going to wake them up. Let me just kind of keep myself busy. So I ate some food, I read a book for a little while. And after some time I heard the kids kind of making some noise from the room. You know when kids wake up and they're kind of fussy and they're crying. So I heard some noise from the room, so I got excited, okay, mashallah, they're awake. So I go into the room and I see my kids both sitting on the bed. They've woken up and they're crying, they're fussy, and my wife is lying next to them, but she's not responding, she's not moving. So being a doctor, I jumped right in and I checked her and I found that she had been dead for some time. She just passed away just like that. He said at that moment, it's like my world fell apart. I didn't know what to make of it. I didn't know what I believed. I didn't know what to understand. I just lost my wife, my friend, the love of my life, the mother of my children. Like, what was I supposed to do with myself? He said the first couple of days were a blur. We took care of the janazah and the burial and everything. He said after that, I fell into such a dark place emotionally that he said I had literally locked myself in my room for a couple of weeks where I didn't interact with anyone. I didn't talk to anyone. I just didn't have the motivation to even get out of bed. I just laid there in the dark for days on end. He said during that time, I didn't even hold my kids with my own hands. Like, I just, nothing made sense to me. My world had fallen apart. How was I supposed to look into my kids' eyes and tell them that their mother wasn't coming back? He said, finally, after a few weeks, I got up, started to get my life back together again, reconnect with my children, try to go back to work, figure out how this is all going to work, how I'm going to raise my kids and everything. And he said, after a few months, I seemed pretty functional. I seemed functional again. But he said, one thing was missing. Spiritually, there was a void. I didn't know what I believed. Like, I didn't know if I believed. I didn't know what to do. So I didn't pray, I didn't do anything, there was a spiritual void. And he said my brother, who had been there for me throughout the thing, he wasn't just somebody preaching to me. He had taken care of my kids when I couldn't, and he'd been, really been there for me. My brother came up to me and, you know, he would continue to tell me, listen, you need to pray. It'll help you kind of get over this last step. So he said, finally today, my brother told me that I'm not taking no for an answer. You're going to come with me to the masjid. We're going to go, we're going to listen to the khutbah, we're going to pray salah together with hundreds of other people, and this will help you. So he forced me, he dragged me, he brought me to the masjid. And he said, when you stood up and you talked about this in the khutbah, he said, I immediately found the answer to my question. That if the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had been through this, he understood my pain, he knew what I'm going through. That just like he was able to bounce back, he was able to recover, so can I can recover. But the thing about the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him the ultimate example. Uswatun hasana, the ultimate role model. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested him accordingly. That the wife of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after he lost his wife, he lost his partner. Now some of the books of Seerah mention this in the opposite order, Some say that this happened second, some say it happened first. But in either case, months, literally months apart from the passing of his wife, the uncle of the Prophet ﷺ, Abu Talib, passed away. And you have to understand that when we talk about an uncle passing away, it's not like the uncle you see twice a year at Eid. Not just some random uncle. When it's sad, no, somebody dying is never a good thing. It's sad, but it doesn't affect you, it doesn't like crush you. We again, have been discussing this in the seerah, that Abu Talib just wasn't some ordinary uncle. Abu Talib was the man who raised the Prophet ﷺ. He meant the world to the Prophet ﷺ. He was the family of the Prophet ﷺ. And the Prophet ﷺ loved him so much, and he loved the Prophet ﷺ so much. That Abu Talib would literally care for the Prophet ﷺ in such a way that he wouldn't even care for his own children like that. He cared so much for the Messenger of Allah ﷺ. There's a beautiful story from the seerah which talks about that Abu Talib had many children, he had many kids, so in the morning when all the kids would wake up and they would come for breakfast, you know, the mother would just kind of prepare some food and put it out, and they would all come and eat, and you know how kids get, right? So they're all like climbing over each other and elbowing each other and fighting and pushing and crying and, oh, mom, he's doing this and he's doing that, and she won't give me this and he won't give me that. That this was all going on, this was all happening, and the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, being even from childhood having an exemplary character, he would come and kind of stand in the back, and he wouldn't get involved in the fray, like in the whole, you know, the whole fight and the whole situation. He'd just kind of stand in the back and would let everybody clear out, and if any food was left, he'd come and he'd take his food and he would eat it quietly. Just even a child of amazing character. Abu Talib, the father, he saw this. The uncle of the Prophet, the father of the children, he saw this. And so when he saw this, what he would do every single day is when his wife would prepare the food, he would actually go take some food aside on the side from before, and he would keep it with him. And when all the kids would come to eat the food, and they would again, the whole situation, the whole scene would happen again, and he would see the Prophet standing off the side, he would call him separately. He'd say, come here son, I got something for you. And he would literally sit the Prophet in his lap, and he would give him the food, and he would feed him himself. So much love, that this was the man who raised the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So imagine the pain of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam when Abu Talib passed away. So the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam goes through tragedy upon tragedy. But then like in the story of that man that I told you, like how did the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam recover? How did he deal with so much emotional difficulty, such a huge tragedy? How was he able to emotionally deal with this? When divine revelation first began, and he was being rejected by his family, he was being rejected by everybody, by his community, the people who were supposed to have his back. How did he emotionally deal with that? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him a gift. And that gift was the prayer, the salah. That especially in that year of grief, in that year of sorrow, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called him above the seven heavens. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala there bestowed upon him one of the greatest gifts that has ever been given to any human being. The key to success. But what's very important for us to understand, it's also an emotional outlet. It's also a way to deal with difficulty. It's also a way to deal with adversity. It's also a way to overcome challenges. To get over the hurdles that present themselves in life that are a natural part of life. And that was the salah. That was provided to the Prophet ﷺ. That this will be your emotional outlet. And we see in the life of the Messenger ﷺ that he instituted as such. إِذَا حَزَبَهُ أَمْرٌ فَزَعَ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ. When any situation arose, any situation came up in the life of the Prophet ﷺ, he would at once immediately resort to the prayer. He would immediately turn to the salah. That's how he dealt with things. And subhanAllah, that salah has that power and that ability. I was just mentioning this last night at Irving as well, that even in the Qur'an, the greatest tragedies from the life of the Prophet ﷺ, the passing of his child, when his son died as a child, when his son died, and you can imagine how difficult that is for a parent, how tragic that is for a parent to lose a child. It's unimaginable pain. Unimaginable. In Mansfield, South Arlington, in Mansfield, in our community there, last year, we had a family that's very close to us, is very regular at the masjid. They lost their 5-year-old son. He was hit by a car and he died. And I can't even imagine what it would be like, but just being around them, just witnessing them, just visiting the family, and seeing the pain and the anguish in the eyes of the parents, it broke your heart just being around them, let alone being in that position. It mentions about the Prophet ﷺ that he was in such severe pain at the loss of his child, that the Messenger of Allah ﷺ, even when he wasn't actually like sobbing or crying, he's just walking around, he's just lit. The tears would continue to just stream from his eye. It's like the pain was just, the heart was just being torn up by that pain. Tears would just stream from his eyes. The Sahaba asked him, why do you cry like this continuously? Oh Messenger, where are these tears coming from? And he says, it's just the pain in the heart, I can't help it. Imagine what that was like. And on top of that, the enemies, the opposition to the message, to the Messenger of Allah, they exploited that tragedy of the Prophet ﷺ, and they utilized that as an opportunity to basically launch a campaign against the Prophet ﷺ. Can you imagine that? They launched a campaign against him, where they started calling him abta, cut off, discontinued. Because they said he has no son, his legacy is discontinued, he's been cut off. Imagine how painful that must have been. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala consoled the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but then what tool, what resource, what exercise, what outlet did he grant the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be able to overcome that pain, that personal tragedy, that difficulty? How did he tell him, what will emotionally comfort him? فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ. He said, pray. وَلَقَدْ نَعْلَمُ أَنَّكَ يَضِيقُ صَدْرُكَ بِمَا يَقُولُونَ. Allah told the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that most definitely we know, we understand that your chest becomes tight, becomes constricted, which is an expression in the Arabic language. You know when you're in so much pain and difficulty, you feel like you can't even breathe? Like you feel suffocated, you feel like you can't even breathe? You're in so much pain and anguish, you can't even breathe? Allah said, we know how much pain, what these people say, how much pain that causes you. We know, we understand. But then he said, what can you do in order to bring peace and tranquility? To remove that pain, that anguish, the hurt. How do you get rid of it? He said, فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَكُمْ مِنَ السَّاجِدِينَ. Continue to praise your Lord, and be amongst those who prostrate, who do sujood, who put their face on the ground before Allah. I mean, pray. Pray, it'll feel better. It'll bring you peace and tranquility, calmness, serenity. And so salah is that type of an act. That's what salah is. That's what salah was meant to be in our daily, practical, everyday lives. That's the role that prayer is meant to be. Not just some ritual exercise. It's a tragedy for us. Believe me, it's a tragedy for us that today salah has just become some ritual exercise. It's become a burden, and I'm talking about the very small percentage and minority that actually prays five times a day. That even for them salah is a burden, it's a formality, it's a ritual. Something you have to discharge. You have to take care of. You have to just get done with. But that's what salah was meant to be. But that leads to the obvious question. The question is, brother, I agree with everything you're saying. Salah is great, fantastic, awesome. But my salah doesn't do for me what you're talking about. Like again, that very, very small minority, praying five times a day, regularly, that I've been praying for 5, 10, 15, 20, 30 years, but my salah does not have that effect. My salah doesn't do that for me. It doesn't relieve me like that emotionally. It doesn't help me through my adversity, through my difficulty. What's missing? The key ingredient in salat is that quality, that khushu. But that leads to the million-dollar question, how do we get khushu in our salat? So there's many, many different things we can do. There's literally dozens of recommendations from different scholars that you'll find in books. Entire books have been authored on the subject of finding quality within our prayers. But what I'll do for the sake of our discussion to simplify the conversation, I'm going to group them into three areas of improvement. Three major areas of improvement to gain more quality within our prayers. Number one is the type, a change of lifestyle. It's what I like to call a change of lifestyle. That the way we conduct ourselves, the way we live our lives, outside of the prayer, if you will, aside from the prayer, that will dictate and that will have an impact on the quality of our prayers. You know, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the hadith, in authentic narration, he says, As-salatu nurun. Salah is a nur, it's an illuminating light, it's a force. But Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah taught us a very valuable lesson about that nur, about that light, about that gift. When he talks about knowledge being a light and a gift, he says, Shakotu ila wakir in Surah Hindi fa arshadani bi tarkil ma'asi. That I complained to my teacher wakir that I can't retain, I can't remember. I don't retain what I learned. So he advised me to stop committing sins. Because he said, Al-ilmu nuru min ilahi wa nuru Allahi la yu'ta li'asi. He said, because the knowledge, divine knowledge, sacred knowledge, is a nur, it's a gift from Allah. And this nur, this gift of Allah, is not granted to a sinful person. We have to clean up our act. That when I lie and I cheat and I scheme and I do all these terrible things in my day-to-day life, that will have an impact on my prayer. I can't expect to go from being a terrible human being to all of a sudden standing up for salah, saying Allahu Akbar in instant khushu. It just doesn't work like that. There's no such thing as microwavable khushu. You know when the imam, when we turn on the microphone before the salah, you know, turn on the microphone, and then the imam doesn't say like, hey brother, could you turn on the khushu in the back? No, that's the fan, the button next to it. And you turn it on, the khushu generator buzzes on like, khushu on, and then Allahu Akbar. It doesn't work like that. You don't name a kid khushu and say, come here, you need khushu, sit down here. And when he gets too big, then we have to name another kid khushu, right? Like, it doesn't work like that. It's not some magical thing that just automatically is achieved. It's all one package. It's a holistic experience. So the way we live and conduct our lives will have an impact on the quality of our lives. So we overall have to start making better choices within our daily lives to be able to experience more quality within our prayers. The second area of improvement, to enhance the experience, have quality within our prayers, is what I like to call, turn salah into an event. Salah has to be an important part of your day. Let me explain. Let's take into assessment how we pray. Oh, first let me start with this. Going to work, or going to school for the younger people. Going to work or going to school. If you have to be at work slash school at 8 a.m. and you live a 10-minute drive away from work, so you try to, you have to leave your home, bottom line, you have to leave your home by 7:45. So that 10 minutes to drive there, park your car, walk inside, 7:59, ready to go. Alright, so 7:45 you have to leave your house. Do you wake up at 7:40, roll out of bed, and just basically walk out the door? Okay, see, when you don't respond, then you worry me. Because I, as far as I know, it's a professional community. Alright, so are IT people dirty or something, right? Like, what's going on here? Do you leave home like that when you go to work? Do you do that? Of course not. Alright, so I know, mashallah, okay, you're going to tell me, yeah, wake up for Salat al-Fajr. I'm just talking about in terms of work. If you have to leave at 7:40, how much before that minimum would you wake up in order, how much time would you require in order to get ready to go to work? Half an hour? Terrible. Alright, one time I asked this question to an audience and the sister actually said 2 hours. I said, may Allah forgive you. Alright? Alright? That's terrible, all right? But at the same time, equally terrible is the guy who says 10 minutes, all right, because you smell bad, okay? But the average is usually somewhere, some brothers usually say 30 minutes, sisters usually say an hour, average is about 45 minutes. But if I asked you, brother, why are you going to so much trouble? Why would you wake up 45 minutes before? You'd say, because it's my job, it's my work, it's important. I have to wake up, I have to wash, I have to brush, I have to comb, I have to pack, I have to eat, I have to drink, I have to get ready, get dressed nice, I gotta get ready, it's my job, it's my work. Can't go to work looking like a hobo, right? So it's my job, it's my work, I have to prepare for it, I gotta get my head straight, so that I'm productive when I finally go to work. Now compare that to, and I'm gonna use the most drastic example possible, but I'm going to do that because it serves my benefit, my purpose, all right? Now compare that to how we pray Salat al-Fajr, all right? So Salat al-Fajr, let me explain to you the entire procedure. So we have the route from our bed to our sink so well mapped out in our head that we can walk it with our eyes closed. in the dark. You know why? And this is something nobody admits to, but everybody knows it's true. Because when you wake up from Fajr, you don't like to turn all the lights on. Because it takes the sleepiness away. You know what I'm talking about? Everybody knows what I'm talking about. It's okay, don't admit it. I'll put myself out there, okay? Alright? But you don't like to turn all the lights on because it takes the sleepiness away. So you leave the lights on, you kind of barely open your eyes, one eye enough just so you can go run into something. So you get there. Then secondly, you have perfected the art of the minimal wudu. It's at the point where it's practically a magic trick at this point. Boom! Ta-da, wudu, right? So it's the most unbelievably awesome wudu, alright? So then you come back to your bed and you pray right next to your bed. So that you can engage in a procedure I like to call stop, drop, and roll over, right? You would pray on your bed if it was possible, right? So then, and I know we're laughing and joking, and that's to keep the discussion lighthearted, but honestly, how sad is that that's the state of our salah compared to everything else we do in our lives? So the second area of improving the experience of the salah is to make it an important event and a part of our day. There should be time set aside for it. There should be a build up to it. Making wudu properly, setting time aside for it. You know, one thing that's recommended is that just like in the masjid, Salat al-Isha is at 9 o'clock. That means Salat al-Isha is at? What if the Imam didn't show up? Salat al-Isha is at? Alright, we're a little crazy about that, right? So that's one example. But in our personal lives as well, what's recommended to us is that we also fix the time of salah. The Prophet ﷺ recommended as-salatu ala awwali waqtiha, to pray salah at its very first time as soon as it comes in. But if somebody can't manage that, at least fix an iqama, personal iqama time for yourself. So that you hold yourself to that. It becomes a schedule. You treat it, you take it more importantly. Another recommendation, making wudu properly. Another recommendation that this Ibn Kathir rahimahullah, he says that al-khushu yuhsalu liman farraga qalbahu lis-salah. Khushu will be achieved and attained by the one who frees his heart for the prayer. So a recommendation made by scholars, especially for us, because we live in the age of the distraction. We live in the age of the distraction. Like our phones have 8 different types of tones on them. It's phone and it's email and it's text message and it's Twitter and it's Facebook updates. It's everything going on all the time. So one thing that's recommended is taking up 60 seconds. When you're ready to pray, take up 60 seconds where you shut down and turn off everything, put everything aside, and then you just sit down quietly for 60 seconds and just power down, if you will. Just put everything into standby. Just silence and quieter. We're so uncomfortable with silence that the 10 seconds that I was quiet made everybody in this room uncomfortable. I think somebody updated their Facebook status. Awkward silence, right? Right? And then they make that weird face, you know, with the slight, you know? But it's, that's how uncomfortable we are now with quiet and silence. But doing that is very important to gain more khushu within our salah. You know, I always give the example like, you know, this is hometown for me, right? So this is home, this is Dallas, right? So I can talk more freely here, but, you know, like one example I often give is how we pray right now. So, like, sometimes when we text messaging, where do you want to go eat after the lecture is over, send a log order? Now what happens 15 seconds later? Even if you did silence your phone, now you're thinking, where do they want to go eat? Right? Now your mind's connected there. Like, I always give this example of watching a game. Right? Because, alhamdulillah, this is the home of the NBA champion Dallas Mavericks. Everybody say, alhamdulillah. We're a Heat jersey. Everybody say astaghfirullah. Right? And he actually told me, check this out. I love these kids, right? It's called, by the way, for the adults, this is called trolling, okay? Alright? What he did was, he actually came up to me before the lecture started and goes, I especially wore this because I knew you were coming here and I knew it would bother you, right? I love this brother for the sake of Allah and nothing else, alright? So no, of course not. I'm just playing around. Just don't know. So, mashallah though, I like it. So, but when I go to other cities, I wear Maverick shirts wherever I go. Because it makes people really angry. So, mashallah. But, so when we watch like a football game, which is a sore subject around here, because may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide the Cowboys. See, I mean, alright. So, but when we watch a game, when we watch a football game, watch a basketball game, first of all, if you actually pray while watching a game, you are basically a wali of this zaman, right? You're like a waliullah, right? Like, who actually prays during the game is coming on? But even if you do pray astaghfirullah, what's the quality of that prayer? What's the quality of that salah? So we leave the TV on just a little bit, right? First of all, it's like as soon as it's time out or halftime, it's like, come on, go, right? Hurry up. And one guy goes, hey, I gotta go make wudu, bro. It's like, you every single time. Get it together, right? And then when we do actually go and pray, then we leave the volume on just a little bit, just so we can hear if anything drastic happens, right? Just make sure we don't miss anything. And then God forbid if like some like, you know, overzealous brother ends up leading the prayer, and it's like, oh no, crisis mode. Who told this guy to lead salah, right? So that's the quality of the prayer, even if we are praying. So a very important recommendation is for salah to actually be something important, to set out time for it. And as a recommendation for maybe those brothers and sisters who might not be praying regularly 5 times a day, you know what? It's actually very simple. I don't want to overburden you by making you think that you have to take out an hour for every single salah, but start at least with your fard. Those who are already praying should pray their sunnah and their nawafil, but if somebody doesn't pray 5 times a day, start with your fard. But make it count. Take out 10 minutes and make those 4 rakats count. Do it properly. Free yourself up and invest yourself into that for that 10, 15 minutes. And make it count. And that's a huge area of improving the experience and the quality of the prayer. The third and final area of improvement, and this is where we'll kind of wrap it all up, is the actual prayer itself. What can we do within the prayer to enhance the quality of it? Now there's lots of different things within the prayer which boil down to basically 2 major areas of improvement. Number one, knowing the fiqh of salah, knowing the technicalities and the structure of the prayer. Now I'm going to say this as somebody who teaches fiqh, all right? Being certified and a teacher of fiqh, I'm going to say this very openly, that fiqh is very, very important, because otherwise you don't know how to pray. But at the same time, what the fiqh does for you, as a teacher of fiqh, what fiqh does for you is it gives you the skeleton, the outline, the structure of the prayer. What is still the soul, just like the skeleton, the outer shell of this human being, it'll give you a nice shell in the skeleton. It does contribute to the khushu, don't get me wrong. But the soul and the spirit of that prayer is just, take as an analogy, take as a parallel, the example of reciting the Qur'an. Tajweed is very important, and tajweed actually helps you concentrate in reading the Qur'an. When people learn proper tajweed, they say, one of their observations, I enjoy reading Qur'an more. But at the same time, while it takes you a certain way towards achieving greater focus, tadabbur, concentration, even when reciting Qur'an, at the end of the day, tajweed, what it does is it gives you that formal outline, that structure, so you at least recite properly. But where does that real life-changing experience in the recitation of the Qur'an come from? Come on, everybody knows. What do you have to do if you want the recitation of the Qur'an to change your life? What do you have to do? Understand it. You gotta understand what you're reading. Unless and until that happens, it'll change your life. So similarly, for the salah, that fiqh will give you that shell, that outer shell, the structure, the skeleton. And that's great, that's desperately needed. But the soul of the prayer, where that life-changing experience happens, it happens when you understand what you read and what you say within your prayer. Because that's where the reflections come from. That's where the tadabbur, the tafakkur comes from. That's where you reflect on what you're reading and it changes your life. That's what we need. So to just share a little bit, all right? To share a little bit, because we should always have some type of, you know, tangible benefit that we go home with from every lecture, from every program. There's something we should be able to take home to implement immediately. I'd like to share a couple of these parts, basic parts of the prayer, as a reflection, all right? The very first thing that I'll share with you here is takbir, Allahu Akbar. All right. Now, if somebody was to ask me, like if you were to ask someone, what does Allahu Akbar mean? What do we reflect on? What is the khushu of Allahu Akbar? What is the reflection in Allahu Akbar? Allahu Akbar means Allahu Akbar. It's just a formality. It's a transitional phrase. You just say Allahu Akbar. What do you mean? What do you think about? But there's even some reflection there. There's something to think and ponder upon. Allahu Akbar, what does it mean? Allah is the... Right, all right? So, typically what you hear, what you read, what you see is that Allahu Akbar means Allah is the greatest. But when we actually get down, Allah is the greatest. That's a fact. But when we get down into the technicalities of the language, what we understand is that Akbar, that word, Arabic is a language of patterns. The Akbar pattern is the comparative, not the superlative. Not even that's technical language. Let me simplify. For example, if I was to say, Zayd is faster than Khalid. Zayd is faster than Khalid. But Ahmad is the fastest. Faster is the comparative. Fastest is a superlative. Akbar can be used as a superlative, but it's a very specific function. Typically, Akbar by itself, af'al Akbar by itself, this is the comparative, not the superlative. So meaning Allahu Akbar means Allah is greater. But if I was to stand before you and say Zayd is faster than, and then just stop there, obviously you would wait for me to, you would expect me to finish. Because I didn't finish the idea, I didn't finish the thought. Similarly, when we say Allahu Akbar, it's as if we're saying Allah is greater than blank. There's a blank, there's an open space, it's left open-ended. Why is that done? This is a very specific rhetorical function in the Arabic language. It's basically a function of balagha. It's very, very commonly found in the Quran. That when a statement demands an object and that object is not provided, it's done so that you can customize the message for yourself. You're supposed to fill in that blank for yourself. Allahu Akbar means Allah is greater than whatever is distracting me from my prayer at this very moment. So when the game is on television, Allah is more important than the game. The restaurant is going to close, Allah is more important than the restaurant. That when my friend is waiting for me outside, Allah is greater than my friend. When the phone is ringing, Allah is greater than the phone call. You're supposed to customize that message to focus yourself so that you can start the prayer properly. And continue to refocus yourself every single time you say this within the salah. That is simply the reflection and the thought process involved in saying, Allahu Akbar. Now imagine understanding and appreciating every single word of the prayer in that same fashion, where you have thoughts and you have reflections and you reflect on every single word in the prayer. What a life-changing, life-altering experience that would be. I'll end here, we have one more minute. I'll end with one more extra example, since alhamdulillah we have a minute left. Sujood. It's a beautiful position of the prayer, we're all familiar with it. What do we say in our sajda, everybody? Subhana rabbiyal a'la. Alright? How absolutely perfect is my Lord, my Master, who is al-a'la. Now, al-a'la, this is the superlative. It means the highest. It's superlative because of the lamu ta'rif, because of the al, it's superlative. The highest, the most exalted. So, subhana, how absolutely perfect is my Lord, the highest. Now, what's really beautiful about that is what position do we say that in? In our sajda, in our sujood. What do we do in sajda? Where do we put our face? We put our face on the floor, on the ground. The most respectable part of our body is our face. It's our identity, right, everybody? Okay, y'all are kind of slow today, all right? So I'm going to help you out here. What do you have on your driver's license? You have a picture of? Your face. Nobody goes like this, boy, I take a picture, everybody knows who that is. Right? You don't do that. What do you have on your driver's license? Your face. It's who you are. It's your identity. It's your dignity. It's your respect. We put the most noble, respectable part of our body, our face, we put it on the ground, where a minute ago somebody had their feet. There is no position possible, there's no lower position possible for a human being. That is the lowest that you can put yourself is by putting your face on the ground. We willingly put ourselves in the lowest position humanly possible. The most humble position possible, we put our face on the ground, and in that position we say, Allah is the highest. That's the reflection of sajda. That's what we're supposed to be thinking while we say subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we actually start doing that, we implement that, life-changing experience. So inshallah, I hope everybody benefited and was able to get something to inshallah take home and immediately implement from tonight's program. Also wanted to inform everyone, tonight's lecture is in connection with inshallah a full weekend program called Meaningful Prayer that we're going to be having at the Irving Masjid, not far from here, the Islamic Center of Irving, inshallah. Day after tomorrow, Friday evening, inshallah, starting at 7 p.m. at ICI. We're going to be starting this program called Meaningful Prayer. What the basic premise of the program is, that we're going to take every single word in the salah, like we did a couple of words today, like al-a'la and akbar, we're going to take every single word in the salah, take it apart, understand what it means, and develop the ability to reflect on it. All the way from beginning to end. We're going to do the whole thing. This is a course, alhamdulillah, I've taught more than 50 times across the country. I just taught it in Boston last weekend, and I've actually taught it here in Dallas a couple of years ago in Richardson. So alhamdulillah, through the efforts of some of the brothers, we were able to, alhamdulillah, bring the course back to be conducted at ICI. So we're going to be doing that, starts the day after tomorrow. I wanted to invite everyone and request everyone to inshallah come. Friday evening session is open to everybody. There's no prerequisite for the program. There's no restriction for the program. Everybody's welcome. Everyone's invited. It's open to brothers and sisters, audiences of all background and all ages. And the Friday evening session, it doesn't even require any type of registration. Just come Friday evening, 7 p.m. And what we will do, we'll explore the in-depth meaning of Surah Al-Fatiha. We'll go through every word in Surah Al-Fatiha, understand what it means, and also take into note how when we recite Al-Fatiha within our prayers, it's a direct conversation between us and Allah. So we'll explore that entire conversation, inshallah. So I wanted to inform everyone, request everyone, and recommend everybody come and join us, inshallah. Jazakum Allah khairan. Assalamu alaikum. If anybody's got, I guess maybe we could take one or two questions, because we do have to prepare for the salah. But if anybody does have a quick question or two, we can take it, inshallah. I was worried about that. Like, if there's no questions, does that mean it was really good, very thorough? Or does that mean it was just that terrible? Like, somebody just woke up, like, I don't know what to ask a question about. I just woke up. All right, so either way, jazakumullah khairan. All right, hopefully it was the former, not the latter, but... or the latter, whatever. I'm confused at this point. So, jazakumullah khairan, everyone, for coming. We're going to have the adhan. We'll get ready for the salah. And I'll hopefully see everyone Friday night. Assalamu alaikum.